Hello, my name is Sarah Richardson and I'm Head of English at Malcolm Arnold Academy. I'm here today to talk to you a bit about devising a new QSH 3 curriculum. The examples I'm going to give are all from my experience of working as part of a working party. It's been an absolute privilege over the last few months to be part of a working party. We've been designing a new curriculum for use in English across our trust. But what I want to focus on in this talk today is not really about English, but about how you might go about getting started. I want to focus on the very early process of the questions you might ask yourself if you are trying to start designing a new curriculum in QSH 3. So, no further ado. Step one is to think about why do you teach what you teach? What is the point of your subject? We use this question as a starting point to devise for ourselves a mission statement. And we came back to this mission statement frequently throughout our conversations because this is why we think our subject matters. We knew that we wanted to make sure we were teaching them at QSH 3 knowledge which would underpin their future study. We also wanted to make sure we were teaching them things that would help them join the club to be able to engage in moral, philosophical debate and hold their own in maybe more unfamiliar circumstances. We want to teach them knowledge that they won't get unless we teach it to them. We want to be ambitious for them. And lastly, we wanted to make sure we taught knowledge which says something about the world that matters. And I suppose as a counter to that, we wanted to make sure that we weren't just including things on this new curriculum because we taught it before or because it was on the GCSE specification. We wanted to make sure we had a really good reason to include that at QSH 3. Our curriculum time is finite. We don't have unlimited minutes with these students. So it's our moral imperative to make sure that everything we choose to include is worth teaching. We've got to be selective by very nature, so we need to make sure we are actively making those selective decisions with integrity. Now, having discussed that, spent quite a lot of time discussing it, we came up with this paragraph. And I hope as you read it, you can see the ambition in it, that we are bold, that we want to make sure we are exposing our students to new things and giving them an appreciation for literature, the domain of literature, and understanding why it matters. Okay, so having created that quite nebulous paragraph, which is very ambitious, but it could be quite difficult to understand how practically that comes to be a curriculum map that can be taught across a number of schools. We were focusing on literature, so all the examples I'll show you in a minute are focused on a literature curriculum, but these two questions were absolutely vital to us. Now, we started with question one, but as we were doing question one, we found ourselves inevitably talking about question two, and then we sort of jumped between the two till we got to the point of being able to map our curriculum out. So I'm going to explain a little bit about the thought process that goes behind these two questions and why I think they're so useful, whatever subject you're looking at. So to start off with, what are the underpinning aspects that you might expect to teach in your subject area? Now, this should be quite a granular, specific list that lets you break down your whole subject area into the crucial concepts that students need to understand. And this is where we're really thinking about the journey from novice to expert. We know what students need to be able to do at the end of year nine, and then we wanted to be able to track that back, particularly for a subject like English. The procedural knowledge was really crucial for us. So we broke down the ability to write an essay at the end of year nine into the steps that we knew we needed students to be taught, to master really, so that they were able to get to that point of being able to write an extended essay on a piece of literature. You can see the things that we've got on this list, and this is where we're trying to think, what must we teach? Quite specific, quite granular, but making sure that we know what we want to include throughout those 3 years. And as I said, while we were talking about this, we found ourselves getting a bit distracted. We started to think a little bit about how we might teach this, not just what we needed to teach, but how we were going to teach it. We were talking about this text or that text. And actually that was distracting us a bit from making sure that we were really collating our focus, which is why we then came to question two. What are the crucial areas of study for your domain? And at this point, this is where you're kind of thinking about the domain as a whole and seeing case history as that foundation. If students are only exposed to your subject in your classroom, what must be covered? What experiences do students need to have? What story do you want your curriculum to tell? How will you balance canonical concepts alongside diversity and inclusion? Now, these were the things that we felt a good case history curriculum must address. Now, it's not to say that we would have a topic on each of these. I mean, a whole term on the Gothic, or a whole term on literature, a whole term on dystopia. But we wanted to make sure that we were including these, because if a curriculum is going to be as ambitious as we've set it out to do, if it is going to expose students to a set of diverse and canonical writers, these were the things we felt we needed to include. We also felt we wanted to consider some of the concepts that run through literature across time. So we came up with this list. We hoped that by making this list, we would keep a sense of integrity, that we would be able to make sure that our curriculum was broad and rich and balanced. So by creating these two lists, we were actually trying to break our subject down, rather than being this nebulous, beautiful thing that we love, into these parts and components that we could then map. And the whole aim of doing this, and this is the early stage, is to make sure that when you then start thinking about what am I going to do in year seven, term one, in year seven, term two, that you are making sure that your curriculum is still considering everything that needs to be considered, that you're not missing out a really crucial concept that is fundamental to becoming an expert in your domain. So if you are going to follow this process and you want to try this, you will probably inevitably get stuck somewhere along the way. And these are some things that I found helpful when we were getting stuck. Look at what other schools include on their curriculum maps in your subject area. By asking these kind of questions, I was able to think about what I think is important and to use these questions to guide my own decision making on what I thought we ought to teach and why we should teach that. I'd also encourage you to ask other people what they think. The teachers who will be delivering that curriculum are vital and they must contribute and make suggestions. I've got a really supportive SLT at Malcolm Arnold who were really helpful and generous with their advice, which I also found very useful. I'd also recommend asking critical friends who are outside your context. We were quite fortunate that we were a working party of five staff who could discuss our different contexts and bring that together. If you're doing this on your own, make sure you are seeking other people's thoughts. Listen to what they say and make sure you act on it. Keep an open mind. When you are in these early stages, I'd really encourage you not to think about what's practical, but what is important. What are those underpinning things that students absolutely need to be exposed to in the time you have with them at Key Stage 3? So, having gone through those two processes of collating the key knowledge that you want to deliver and the key concepts that underpin your subject, you will be at the point that we're at the moment. So we have organised and arranged all of those concepts and knowledge into a logical progression, thinking about the curriculum as progression model, where we're thinking about what we need to master in what order, what do you need to know here so that you can learn this. We're also thinking a bit about things like maturity and difficulty with some of the concepts that we want to include. We're at the point of seeking feedback. We're reorganising and rearranging, seeking more feedback, reorganising, rearranging. And this process I know is going to go on a little bit longer. But because we have got that mission statement, because we've got that list of underpinning aspects, and because we've got that list of crucial areas of study, we're able to make sure that our curriculum continues to maintain the aim that we have set out for it to fulfill. We're still including all those things. We're making sure that our students are exposed to the important things that they need to learn so that they can become experts in our subject area. And here is our year seven as it currently is. Now, I'm not saying this is how it will be forever, but this is what we currently have as our year seven curriculum. If you have an eye for detail, you will see that the core disciplinary procedural knowledge threshold concepts all come directly from the granular list that we originally created, with a few additions to be more specific as we focus on the particular things we're going to teach. You'll also see that those overriding concepts are addressed at different points, depending on what we are looking at. If you do have any comments, discussions or questions, please get in touch with me via Twitter. I have put some further reading on the next slide, which might be helpful to you if you are early on this journey. But thank you very much for listening.